This program is brought to you by Link TV for educational and non-commercial use only. Mosaic, a daily news program from Link TV, presents a selection of news reports from independent and state-controlled broadcasters from throughout the Middle East.
The United Nations says 13,000 refugees have fled their homes because of the war. Many are taking shelter at UN schools in Gaza City.
And Shireen Tadros spoke to some refugees who say although they have left their homes, there is nowhere that they actually feel safe.
They fled the front lines of this war, knowing that Israel's assault would follow them. In Gaza, nowhere is safe and nobody is immune from the onslaught. There are hundreds of refugees now living in makeshift shelters like this one in Gaza City. 13,000 have already been driven from their homes, according to the United Nations. Noha left her home on the outskirts of the strip with her husband and three children. Her youngest, Marwa, hasn't been changed in 3 days. The milk she's drinking is the last bottle Noha has for her.
I want to tell people outside to do something. Why is this Palestinian blood so cheap to you? Why are our neighbors living in peace but we are deprived of that? What have the children done to deserve this? Why should my daughter drink milk from a dirty bottle? She won't even take it anymore. What did we do wrong? They bring us some milk, a blanket. We don't want it. We want to go home and eat and sleep and live like everyone else. Where is the great Arab world that they taught us about at school? They have left us. Shame on them.
Conditions here are deteriorating. Creating a clean, safe shelter in a war zone is no easy task.
The school simply isn't equipped to deal with the number of refugees that are now staying here night after night. This is the only place that they can get clean water. You can see that most of the taps aren't even working, and people are using the water here to wash themselves, to wash their hands, their feet, and now they're using it to drink with. It's the only water that's clean in the whole school.
We could feel the anger all around the shelter. Disappointment at the inaction of the international community and rage at the Arab leaders who they feel have sold them out.
Where are the authorities? Where are our leaders? They have shut their eyes. Why is it that children around the world are allowed to live in peace but not Palestine's children? Aren't we all the same, the children of God? We just want to be free to live in peace.
61 members of Sobhi Rizk's family are now living in this shelter. His granddaughter Amel was overwhelmed by what was happening around her.
I'm crying for the children of Gaza that have been thrown in the streets. We have nothing to do with this. We don't fire rockets. We don't know what this war is about. Why should children be forced to drink dirty water? What did we do wrong? Where is everyone?
Refugees are a casualty of every war. But in Gaza, there is nowhere safe to flee. Israel says its enemy is Hamas. But while it fights its battle, it keeps 1.5 million people trapped inside the war zone it's created. Shireen Tadros, Al Jazeera, Gaza City.
Well, The occupation forces have not stopped, neither day or night, from targeting the Palestinian people and escalating the offensive by ground, air, and sea. But the resistance has continued to stand firm. It reached a significant milestone by striking locations north of Ashdod for the first time.
This house had more than five families living in it, with more than 40 children. They were sleeping peacefully in the house when the bomb fell on them. The children, we couldn't even find them.
This is Gaza, standing barefoot on the thorns of pain. Here they search for the corpses of the home's inhabitants, or rather their remains, after a strike targeted entire families. The tormented cries of an angel fill the universe, and the bird's throat is pierced with daggers. The ambulances do not stop if they succeed in escaping the bombing. They continuously transport children who have been slaughtered by the steel of the new age. Those whose hands have been severed or those whose tender bodies have been pierced by the shrapnel. Here they are with bloody faces and teary eyes, filled with fear, or perhaps they are just sleeping. As for the parents who survived, they go through fire once again, tracing the blood, perhaps guiding them to their children.
Oh, people, all my children have been martyred.
Neither a word nor a picture can describe the ordeal of this man. Nothing is more powerful than the perseverance shown by these brave men, whose tears were mixed with the blood of the martyrs. And nothing is more superb than the tears of these women who have cried in sadness. Amidst this, no one believes that Gaza is on the verge of collapsing. What are people saying here?
The occupation is not able to defeat pockets of resistance. It is not able to reach the resistance or its fighters. The fighters of the military wing from the Qassam, Jerusalem, and Aqsa brigades took a unified position as they continue to pound the occupation forces. The occupation didn't expect that the Palestinian resistance would fight at such a high level. The occupation couldn't defeat the resistance, so it's fighting the civilians. Israel has unleashed its rage on the civilians in an attempt to kill as many of them as possible. The Israeli occupation, which has failed to defeat the Palestinian resistance, is taking its anger out on the Palestinian citizens.
In the rest of the Palestinian territories, the circle of the public mobilization continues to widen. This news comes as many Palestinians in several West Bank villages, towns, and camps took to the streets, chanting slogans for the resistance and the armed struggle. Meanwhile, the Palestinians are warning that ongoing aggression on the Gaza Strip will drag the entire region into the unknown. Yusuf Al-Mahmoud, Syrian Arab TV, the occupied Arab territories.
A short time ago, a Hamas-fired rocket struck a kindergarten in Ashdod. Fortunately, it was closed and empty. Several onlookers were treated for shrapnel wounds and shock. Between 11 p.m. last night and 7 o'clock this morning, not a single rocket was fired into Israeli territory for the first time since the Gaza operation began. But the quiet was short-lived. Hamas has fired over 30 mortars and rockets into southern Israel so far today. We get more from IBA's Leah Stern.
Rishon LeZion and Tel Aviv have all begun preparing their bomb shelters, even though they say that they have received no word from the IDF Home Front Command of any change in the security situation. But these municipalities say they'd rather be safe than sorry, fearing that Hamas may have missiles with a range over 40 kilometers. In Ashkelon, residents there woke up to relative quiet this morning. Shops and cafes that had been closed for a week now began opening their doors. But the calm was shattered later in the day when two Grad missiles exploded in the seaside city. One landed in a residential neighborhood, slightly damaging the sidewalk. The other missile hit an open area. Later, sirens sounded in Ashdod, Ashkelon, and Beersheba. Five Grad rockets and a Qassam landed in open areas across the western Negev and the southern coastal plain. Two landed in the Sderot area, one in someone's yard. 9 people were lightly injured in the attacks, and several people were treated for shock. A Grad rocket exploded this morning in an open area in the town of Yavne, about 40 kilometers from the Gaza Strip. There were no reports of injuries or of damage. On day 10 of Operation Cast Lead, tax authorities report 627 claims by people whose property has been damaged or destroyed. A preliminary estimate of property damage caused by rocket attacks totaled at least 15 million shekels. But despite the rocket onslaught, residents of southern communities are trying to carry on with their lives. This family celebrated the Brit or circumcision of their son, who was born on Sunday. It was a happy occasion, though the traditional ritual was performed in a local bomb shelter. This is Leah Stern for IBA News.
Defense Minister Ehud Barak says the Gaza operation is proceeding according to plan. Barak was briefing the Knesset Foreign Affairs and Defense Committee, which met at the Ministry of Defense complex in Tel Aviv. According to Barak, Hamas has sustained a very heavy blow, but Israel has not yet achieved its objectives, and therefore the military operation will continue. The defense minister said, quote, Israel is striving to create a new reality in the south, an end to Hamas attacks on Israeli civilians and soldiers, and a dramatic change in the smuggling of weapons into Gaza. Barak stressed that the IDF is watching the northern border carefully. He said, we are prepared and we are on alert and are following all developments. Knesset members Silvan Shalom of the Likud and Zehava Galon of Meretz urged the government to move swiftly to secure a ceasefire that will ensure enduring quiet for residents of the south.
Foreign Minister Tzipi Livni also addressed the objectives of Operation Cast Lead at her press conference today.
Before the military operation, the equation was that Hamas targets Israelis whenever he likes, and Israel shows restraint. This is something that stopped in a day in which we initiated the military operation. This is not going to be no longer the equation in this region. When Israel is being targeted, Israel is going to retaliate. Israel is going to give an answer to it, because this is an ongoing long battle, war against terror. We have nothing against the Palestinians, more than that. According to the Annapolis process, we decided to adopt a dual strategy to launch a peace process with the pragmatic leaders of the Palestinians in order to create a vision of peace, to translate the vision of two-state solution for the benefit of both our peoples, Israelis and Palestinians as well. Now, as long as Hamas controls Gaza Strip, as long as it doesn't accept the requirements of the international community, as long as it's not willing to accept the requirements of the international community, and part of it is the vision of two states, is an obstacle not only to Israel, but to the entire international community and to the Palestinians as well. So we changed the equation. Now we have some military objectives within Gaza Strip. And this is, as I said before, a long battle against terror.
New York City Mayor Michael Bloomberg visited Israel yesterday in a show of solidarity, accompanied by Democratic Congressman Gary Ackerman and New York Police Commissioner Raymond Kelly. Bloomberg traveled to Ashkelon and Sderot, where he met with local leaders as well as New Yorkers who have immigrated to Israel. The mayor expressed his strong support for the nation and for its right to defend itself.
Israel is doing the right thing and defending itself. It has a responsibility to defend its citizens. Elect Obama's quote when he said if his daughters were here and they were threatened, he would do everything that he possibly could to defend them.
The situation facing civilians in Gaza brings to mind the Fourth Geneva Convention, which was signed in 1949 in order to bring some protection to civilians during wars and conflicts.
The ongoing Israeli attacks on Gaza and Lebanon in the past raise questions on whether Israel respects the Fourth Geneva Convention, which it signed.
أقرت اتفاقية جنيف الأربع عام 49.
The Fourth Geneva Convention was signed in 1949. Now 194 countries have signed it, including Israel. The objective is to protect people who are not participating in the fighting, such as doctors, the injured, and the ill. Three additional protocols were added to the Geneva Convention, but the Israeli attack on Gaza raises important questions about the country that has killed and injured thousands of civilians and destroyed hundreds of civilian buildings. The first protocol leaves wiggle room on how to define civilians, though it does not allow for the targeting of civilians just because they are near non-civilian targets. However, the Israeli policy clearly considers Palestinian targets as military targets if resistance fighters are located there.
لكن الواضح أن السلوك العسكري الإسرائيلي يعتبر الفلسطينيين أهدافاً عسكرية.
The 57th article of the convention calls for suspending any attack if it turns out that attacking a military target will cause injuries amongst civilians or destroy civilian buildings. The 51st article bans random attacks, which includes the targeting of military targets near civilians. Israel, however, has targeted civilian buildings such as the Palestinian Parliament and the Islamic University in Gaza. The justification given by Israel for attacking the university, for example, is that the university's labs are used for military purposes. Article 52 describes a target as military if it leads to a military achievement once destroyed. But does this apply to the case of the Islamic University in Gaza? Cameras have captured images of mosques collapsing on homes after being bombed. In one of the incidents, five sisters were killed. The incident violated an additional protocol of Article 53, which calls for the protection of cultural institutions and places of worship. Article 59 bans the targeting of any place lacking defense systems.
في حين أن إسرائيل تستهدف بالطائرات الحربية مواقع لا توجد فيها أي وسيلة للدفاع الجوي.
Meanwhile, Israel is using its warplanes to target places lacking air defense systems. Articles 76 and 77 calls for the protection of women, with special emphasis on the protection of pregnant women and the children in general. However, the current Israeli attack proves that the well-being of children and civilians in general is the last thing on the mind of those standing behind the destructive Israeli war machine in Palestine, and before that, in Lebanon.
عقدة القطاع أو لعنة غزة ليست جديدة على الإسرائيليين والتي تمثل لهم مكانا أشبه بالجحيم.
The complexity of the Gaza Strip, or the curse of Gaza, is not a new expression in Israel. Since the withdrawal of the Israeli forces from the Gaza Strip in 1994, Israelis have often described the coastal enclave as the place from hell. The late Israeli Prime Minister Yitzhak Rabin once said that he hoped the sea would swallow Gaza.
Go to Gaza. This is the expression used by the Israelis when one of them gets mad at another, rather than using the phrase go to hell. To the Israelis, Gaza has been hell, which prompted the withdrawal of occupation forces from there in 1994 and once again in 2005. Since 1948, Ben-Gurion expressed fear over the occupation of Gaza. The late Israeli Prime Minister Yitzhak Rabin hoped that the sea would swallow Gaza, which was his worst nightmare as defense minister. The total area of the Gaza Strip measures less than 362 square kilometers, with a population of 1.5 million people. Most of the residents are refugees who fled to Gaza in the aftermath of the 1948 Nakba, or catastrophe. Under the given circumstances, Gaza has become a ticking time bomb. Under the Egyptian administration of Gaza during the reign of Abed Nasir, the influence of the Muslim Brotherhood expanded to the Gaza Strip, and since then it continued growing. In 1967, Israel occupied the Gaza Strip and a wide range of other territories. Soon afterwards, Gaza turned into a hotspot under the control of the resistance. This prompted Ariel Sharon, then the head of the military unit, Nahil Brigades, to inflict painful blows on the Gaza Strip.
الإسرائيلي الوحيد الذي رفض فكرة التخلي عن القطاع كان مناحم بيغن.
The only Israeli official who rejected the withdrawal of the Israeli forces from the Gaza Strip was Menachem Begin, who called for the construction of more settlements in the coastal enclave. However, Yitzhak Rabin agreed to withdraw from the most populated areas of the Gaza Strip, in conformity with the Oslo Accord. In 2005, Ariel Sharon, then Israel's prime minister, authorized a unilateral withdrawal by the Israeli forces from the Gaza Strip. However, the nightmare of Gaza continues to this present day, haunting Israel. Maisa Aklin, Al Arabiya.
It does not matter whether you agree or disagree, and to those who do not like it, can drink from the Sea of Gaza.
Thanks to Maisa on this historical and comprehensive report, and for providing us with background analysis of the Palestinian plight. We are joined by retired Brigadier Colonel Ilyas Ana, an expert in military affairs from Beirut. Why is Gaza the most difficult issue for Israel, and why is it a nightmare for the Israelis?
As the report mentioned, historically, Gaza was an issue of interest for the Egyptians. Throughout history, the Jews have expressed interest in the West Bank and the north towards Lebanon. Today, Israel and Egypt want the Gaza Strip, whether it's under the control of Hamas or the Palestinian Authority, to be a geopolitical player without military capabilities that could threaten the region. Egypt doesn't like to see any country in the region expand its political influence in the Gaza Strip because the enclave is a normal territorial expansion for Egypt. However, Gaza has become an imminent threat to Israel's national security, especially when considering the use of advanced weapons and the expansion of the settlements. Along with Beersheba, many Israeli settlements are becoming easy targets and are within reach of the rockets. Today, Israel doesn't like to see a united and armed Palestinian Authority. Israel wants the Gaza Strip to remain under the political control of Hamas and the West Bank under the political control of the Palestinian Authority, but without military capabilities. With this, Israel will be able to divide the Palestinians ideologically and geographically. Then, Israel will be able to give the Gaza Strip back to Egypt and the West Bank back to Jordan. And this is what Egypt fears the most. With this, Israel will be able to end the Palestinian plight, and this is where the Egyptian fear originates.
أعلن جيش الاحتلال الإسرائيلي توسيع هجومه البري في قطاع غزة لليوم الثالث على التوالي.
The Israeli occupation army announced the expansion of its ground offensive in Gaza for the third day in a row. According to witnesses, Israeli war machines went into uninhabited areas, reaching the Gaza seashore. Meanwhile, clashes have continued since the morning between the Palestinian resistance and the occupation army in the areas where they are gathered. Al-Quds brigades announced having detonated an explosive device in an Israeli unit north of the Zaytun neighborhood. Al-Qassam brigades affirmed having destroyed a van transporting occupation soldiers north of Jabalia, as well as sniping two soldiers west of Beit Lahia. They said that they used a new kind of anti-tank missile for the first time since the beginning of the offensive.
On the 10th day of the Israeli aggression against the Gaza Strip and the third day of the ground incursion, the resistance is still holding firm. It continues to fire rockets towards military locations and settlements. The resistance factions made several announcements affirming that the clashes with the occupation forces are still at the edges of Beit Lahia, Jabalia, and Beit Hanun, north of Gaza. They said that they confronted the infiltrating forces using mortar shells, explosive devices, and for the first time, anti-tank missiles. In a press conference, the Ezzedine al-Qassam brigades announced that the occupation will fail in achieving the objectives of their offensive or stopping the rockets. They warned of expanding the targets of retaliatory attacks to Israeli cities and establishments, which they described as strategic. The spokesman had a map behind him showing cities and settlements, including Tel Aviv and Dimona in the Negev Desert.
We confirm that, thanks to God, our brigades are fine and their power is fine. They are capable, with God's mercy, goodness, and power, to continue for several long months, continuing to intensify the firing of rockets.
Al-Quds Brigade, the military wing of the Islamic Jihad movement, promised to turn Gaza into a graveyard for the occupation forces. It threatened to carry out martyrdom operations against the occupation.
Our alternative and the alternative of martyrdom operations will be a present reality in the coming days, God willing.
Meanwhile, the settlements and ground and air military bases are within the range of the resistance's rockets. Dozens of rockets have injured settlers and soldiers. The city of Ashkelon was struck when the Israeli Trade and Labor Minister was inspecting the city, which made him leave in a state of horror. Ashdod and Beersheba and other cities and settlements are in the range of the resistance's rockets. This means that the areas from which the rockets are being launched, at the furthest points in the north and east, are under the control of the resistance fighters. As for the occupation forces, they have infiltrated into uninhabited areas in the middle of the strip, perhaps with the aim of using this in negotiations at a later phase.
Get more news about the Middle East online at linktv.org/mosaic. The Mosaic webpage offers a complete archive of Mosaic programs, program transcripts, the Mosaic video podcast, and the Mosaic Intelligence Report, a weekly analysis of the hottest stories from the Middle East. The views expressed on Mosaic are those of the participating broadcasters, not Link TV or its sponsors. The production of Mosaic is made possible with the support of viewers like you. Thank you. This program was brought to you by Link TV for educational and non-commercial use only. Link TV is the only U.S. television network devoted to global and national news with uncompromising documentaries and diverse cultural programs. Programs which connect you to the world.